Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Bethel this morning. Welcome on Labor Day weekend. Happy long weekend and happy September. It's the first day of September, and it's good to be here to worship and to bring in a new month. If you are a visitor or a guest this morning, a special welcome to you. There are connect cards in the back of one of the chairs in the row in front of you, hopefully a couple in your row. But those are also for all of you. There are prayer requests on the back of those cards. So if you want to flip that over, fill it out, you can fill in a prayer request and bring it to the Welcome Center after church. That would be great. And this week, Gord Furzer is going to lead us in worship by reading a sermon and offering a few of the liturgical elements. So Gord, thank you for your leadership in the last month without a pastor. So thank you. I'll invite you up now.
Good morning. This morning our call to worship comes from Psalm 95, verses 6 and 7. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, the flock under His care. Let's pray. May God's grace, mercy, and peace be ours. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Yes, everyone, please stand.
We stand and lift up our hands for the joy of the Lord. Our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He? Together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. We stand and lift up our hands for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He? And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord. Filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Filled with His glory.
It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising. Together we sing.
His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. Of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules in nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my. Conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me.
When we gather to praise God, His holiness reminds us of our sinfulness. Yet our holy God is faithful to forgive our sins. So let's confess our sins to Him now together in a time of prayer. Holy God, we often think we love You well, but Your beauty and Your majesty reveals to us that our love for You is a diluted love. Our love for you is divided by other lesser things. Forgive us for not giving you our full attention, our full love. In deep mercy, Lord, spare us. Rekindle our love for you as we see and hear and feel Jesus' love for us. Amen. God assures us of his promise of grace and salvation in these words from Psalm 130. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem from all Israel, from all their sins. Let's praise God together that he has redeemed us in Christ.
Of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus on me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue me from danger interposed this precious blood.
Please be seated. At this time, I'll invite the deacons up to collect the offering. And this morning, our offering is for ministry shares. So ministry shares are gathered, and then they go to the CRC, and they are distributed directly to ministry programs that specifically start new churches, train servant leaders, support chaplains, resource congregations, including our own, and reach out to neighbors through media and evangelism. So as we give today, let's joyfully offer our resources in response to the generous love of God.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. This is the part in our service where we bless our kids. So I'm gonna pray first, and then we'll do the blessing. So if you'll pray with me. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to come together again to your house to worship you as this family of believers. We thank you for each child who is here with us this morning and for those who are away for the long weekend. We just pray that you would bless the time here for each one of our kids this morning. For our littlest ones, as they head off to learn about the prodigal son, we pray that you would bless them and help them to take that lesson away with them. And for those who get to stay in the service this morning, we just pray that they would be able to engage with it as well, and that you would speak to them and meet them where they're at. As they head into this week where they're going to be heading back into routines and school, we just pray that you would be with them, help them to feel calm and to trust that you will be with them and guide them throughout this year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, kids, you can come and stand in the aisles, and we're going to bless you. Awesome. You're all ready? Okay. So everybody can follow along on the screen. Congregation, what is our blessing for these children? Good job, kids. Okay, if you are 3, 4, or 5 years old, you get to come with us to Sunday school, and the rest of you get to stay in here with the grown-ups.
This morning's scripture reading is from the first letter to Peter, chapter 1, verse 1 to 9. But before we read, shall we pray? Blessed are you, God of all creation. You spoke in the beginning, and all things came to be. You spoke, and your word came to live with us, full of grace and truth. Bless this place where we would hear your voice. Bless this place where we would hear your story. As we listen, may our ears be attuned to you. As the word is spoken, may you speak to us. May all we hear lead us to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect, exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood. Grace and peace be yours in abundance. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him, and even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Thus far, the reading of God's word.
Thank you. Today's message was written by Pastor Walt Brower, entitled Capture Joy in Tough Times. And before I read, I'm going to give you a quick description of the journey that brought me here. When asked, and I'm sure the others that read sermons may say something similar, when asked to read a sermon, the first thing we do is we go to the CRC North America Library of Sermons for reading. And I read through them until one reaches out to me and it's something maybe I want to hear, something that's been written for me to hear, and I hope some of you will want to hear it. I recognize, it's not a bad sermon at all, I'm giving a preamble. I recognize that when we sing, we are a collective giving worship. This message is about the times where we feel like individuals. So, the words of Pastor Walt Brower. Have you ever noticed that sometimes troubles come in batches? Life can go on smoothly for a while, and then all of a sudden, bang, things go wrong. Not just one thing, but several things at once. And you wonder, what just happened? What hit you? I'm reminded of a quote from Charlie Brown, the cartoon character. Charlie Brown once said, "It always looks darkest just before it gets totally black." Things don't always go as planned. The truth is that no one sails through life without storms. Trouble is something we all have to deal with. A sign on a therapist's door reads, "If you have troubles, come in and let's talk about them. If you don't, come in and tell me how you do it." Listen to the first verse in today's reading. "So be truly glad. There's wonderful joy ahead, even though you may have to endure trials for a little while." I want you to notice the phrase, "you may have to endure trials." What kind of hardship was Peter talking about? Peter's writing to believers who are going through a very difficult time. Those hard times were caused in large part because they were Christians. Peter's writing from Rome, probably only a few months before Rome burned to the ground and the Emperor Nero blamed the Christians. Paul was martyred during the aftermath of Rome's burning. Excuse me. Followers of Jesus already were beginning to be singled out for persecution. Persecution was not universal, and it was not every Christian that was thrown to lions, but some were, and at increasing frequencies. Christians were harassed. You could think of it resembling the period of Nazi Germany in the 1930s. Jews were being ostracized. Their businesses began to be boycotted and vandalized with impunity. There was something ominous in the air about terrible things to come. Such were the times at which Peter was writing. But it really doesn't matter what kind of trials make life tough. No matter where our tough times come from, Peter's message offers insight to all who are facing hardship. I mean, what do you do when you're faced with cancer? What do you do? How do you respond when a spouse decides to walk out on you? How do you handle the reversal of nature and you go through the excruciating pain of losing a child? How do you deal with a habit that's messing up your life, but you can't break its grip on your life? And so when Peter begins his letter, he does not express how sorry he is that life can be so hard. Instead, he gives praise to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then he adds, "So be truly glad. There's wonderful joy ahead, even though you have to endure many trials for a little while." Notice how Peter talks about being truly glad about wonderful joy in the midst of serious hardship. And so the question I want to answer today is, what reasons does Peter give to back up such gladness and joy? What can Christ followers still find reason for joy when times are tough? From 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 to 9, I want you to notice 5 insights for joy beyond tough times. First, God reminds me I'm only passing through. Peter writes to encourage you and I. And his encouragement is based on the premise, we're only passing through. This world is not our home. Notice verse 1. To God's chosen people who are temporary residents of the world, we need to have a long view of life. This life as we know it will not last forever. We and this world will pass. And there's going to come a time when you and I, as followers of Jesus, will be coming home. Because we're not home yet. You see, it's great to be a Christian on this side of eternity. It's great to be a Christian now because you know you've been forgiven. You don't have to live with any regrets. And you know your life is significant. God has given your life meaning and purpose. And it's great to be a Christian because God is with you. He has adopted you and loves you. But the final homecoming outweighs any earthly benefit. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19, paraphrased, says, if all we get out of Christ is a little inspiration for a few short years, we're a pretty sorry lot. Jesus wasn't merely a good teacher who provided us with some inspiration on how to live life. He came to give everlasting life. He came to bring us home. And when life gets tough, you and I need to remember that. No matter how hard the slugging is today, we're only passing through. Second, God reassures me of a living hope. Would you agree with me that on this side of eternity, we all need massive doses of hope? Imagine a neighborhood in town that was advised that all the houses would be bought up, expropriated by the city to make way for a new highway. And the city decided to give the residents 5 years notice so that they could cash out and find another house to make their home. What would happen to those yards? They'd be neglected. Fences would not be repaired or repainted. Renovations that were long planned would be canceled. Leaky roofs would be patched instead of replaced. And of course, the city would no longer be interested in the upkeep of the neighborhood. Cracks in the sidewalks would just be left. Potholes would not get filled in. Playgrounds would suffer neglect. And any stores would be long gone before the bulldozer showed up. So it wouldn't be long before the neighborhood looked uncared for, shabby, and even abandoned. That's the cost of a lack of hope. Peter says in verse 3, God has given us birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. God wants your life to be immersed in hope. Circle the word living. The Christian hope is a living hope. What's the opposite of living hope? The opposite of living hope is false hope. Is there false hope that people cling to? False hope's everywhere. Very simply, every time we say, I hope to see you. Or when we make plans, we say, this is what I'm going to do tomorrow. The truth is, we're really not sure whether our plans will succeed because we're not in control of anything. Even our most hopeful plans are tentative. But the living hope that you have because you're a believer is based not on wishful plans. The hope of which Peter speaks is anchored in an event in history. Your hope and my hope is based on Jesus' resurrection. That's why Peter calls it a living hope. And since no one can undo history, no one can steal a living hope. Third, God redeems me for incorruptible glory. Decima Research reports that over $1 trillion is going to be left from this generation to the next. This Canadian generation will inherit more than any generation before it. Over $1 trillion. Maybe $1 trillion isn't worth what it used to, but it's still a lot. But in the end, it's only cash and stuff. It will be taxed. It will be spent. Much of it on lawyers and accountants. Some of it will be fought over and divide families. Much of it will be squandered. And even if the inheritance is invested in the world's most secure investments, these investments in the end won't last. There's no guarantee that today's fortune will still be there tomorrow. And we know that from the economic ups and downs that we've experienced in our life. The things that are bought will rust through, or wear out, or burn up, or waste away, or be stolen, neglected, spoiled, get out of fashion, or simply cast aside. Such is the nature of perishable, temporary world. But notice in verse 4, God has given us an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. Kept in heaven for you. Your inheritance is in Christ's glory. And it's a glory that can never perish, spoil, or fade. What does that mean? It means that your inheritance in the city, whose maker and builder is God, is incorruptible. Our heavenly inheritance is not like our earthly inheritance. On earth, you may inherit things. In heaven, you inherit the fullness of a love relationship. Fourth, God refines me for a genuine faith. Notice in the first part of verse 7, these trials are only to test your faith, to show that it's strong and pure. It's being tested as fire tests and purifies gold. And your faith is much more precious than gold. Notice what Peter says, when trials come, it's an occasion for us to reflect on how we trust God more in it and through it. God refines you. Why? So you can make $1 million? No. So you can become famous and have everybody admire you? No. God uses trouble in your life to build authentic faith, which God values more than your bank account. You know, it's a general piece of human wisdom to realize that hardship either embitters you or helps you become better. Tough times make people either bitter or better. In most instances in life, what's most important in life is not what trials you face, but how you face them. Will you become bitter or better? One of the most important lessons in life is to realize that God has given us the ability to choose how we respond to tough times. You see, we don't always follow God's will. But even when God's will is not done, we can respond according to God's will. That's why Jesus teaches us to pray, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Because God's will is often not done here on earth. God says, even though it's not my original plan for this world, I want you to use this trouble now to draw you closer to myself. You can still respond in a way that honors me and honors my good, pleasing, and perfect will. And I will draw you to myself. Notice the second part of verse 7. When Jesus wraps all this up, it's your faith, not your gold, that God will have on display as evidence of his victory. You see, all of us leave behind things when we die. There's no forwarding address in heaven at which you can leave an inheritance. You leave it all behind. You can rent a U-Haul one way to Nova Scotia or Vancouver, but you can't rent a one way to heaven. I've never seen a U-Haul behind a hearse. What you take along is your relationship with God. And that relationship is founded on faith. And God says, during those tough times, when you learn to trust me more, those events were so difficult to endure, but to which you responded by trusting me deeper. And it will be put on display. your instances of faith are going to be showcased. And it keeps getting better. There's one more terrific insight for tough times. Fifth, God replenishes me with inexpressible joy. Notice in verse 8, even now you are happy with a glorious, inexpressible joy. I want you to circle even now. That means this day, today, this date, on this moment of your life, even now, you're happy with a glorious, inexpressible joy. God wants to remind you that joy is not something that's reserved for heaven. Joy is something that's reserved for today, for everyone. Everyone who has been born again into a living hope. Now remember, Peter's writing to those who were persecuted, whose jobs were on the line because they were believers, and some of whom were to be arrested and martyred, like Paul and later on Peter himself. And Peter tells them, even now you are happy with a glorious, inexpressible joy. Even now. Please understand that Peter wasn't writing to spiritual giants. There were mature and immature believers among those to whom he was writing. God does not expect you to have reached the stratosphere of spiritual maturity before the joyful times can start. All you need is Christ to have an inexpressible joy. All you need to know is Christ in your situation, and you can be happy with a glorious, inexpressible joy, even now. Even now, capture the joy of belonging to your faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. Notice the final verse, verse 6. So be truly glad, even though it's necessary for you to endure many trials for a little while. You see, God will always be with you. He's bigger than your tough times. Remember, God always honors faith. This coming week will bring good times, exciting times. It'll also bring challenges. Here's what I'd like us to do. Choose joy. Even now, choose joy. Amen.
Please stand and join us in song.
I've known you as a father, I've known you as Good morning. Sorry, that song gets to me. I'm sure many of us can, I'm sure lots of instances are coming to mind. Was not expecting to say this, I'm sorry. Anyways, I'm sure lots of instances come to mind. That song, you can sing it, or maybe you can't sing it at times. But let's take those instances and those images in your mind right now, and let's come before God. Our good Heavenly Father, we humbly come before you on this day, this turning of the calendar, the start of another month, and a stage that can see many changes. We praise you for the promise of cooler nights ahead, but we praise you that that lingering sun we are still seeing on our days. We praise you for new exciting adventures and opportunities. And we still thank you for so many memories of all the ways you've shown up in our lives these summer months. For many of us, we are facing new schedules, routines, the start of school or other activities. Others may be looking at a continuation of what is the norm in their life, be it a happy time or a challenging one. But what is so amazing, what we can surely cling to as a secure promise, is that you are the same amazing God through it all. Your love never fails. You are good all the time. As Lamentations 3 says, because of the Lord's steadfast love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. May we carry that truth with us into whatever we face this week. We pray for our brothers and sisters in this church who are carrying burdens and have heavy needs right now. We pray for protection and healing for Helena, Sid, Kevin, and Lori. We truly praise you for the good news this week that Lori's treatments are working well. Praise to you, God, our ultimate physician. Thank you for showing your glory in this way. We pray for those who are grieving, including Michelle and Mike's family and Michelle and Ryan as they grieve the loss of a beloved brother-in-law and friend. We keep Tony and Carol, Nancy and Steve in our prayers with the loss of Tony's brother Bill, and Sandra, Alice, and Ted with the loss of Sandra's husband Jim. Lord, we pray for all those who are the loved ones, the family members, and the caretakers who love and care for others so well. May you give them perseverance and strength, even when the circumstances feel grim or the challenges keep piling up. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58 says, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. What a truth to cling to as we love and serve each other in this church, in our families, in our schools, and our community. We stand firm because our identity is in you, Christ, and that is secure. We may feel we are in a drought, but we will continue to stand firm because the outcome and the fruit is yours alone to produce. May we continue to simply abide, remain in you, Lord, and let your work be done. And with that truth, that no labor done unto you is ever in vain, may we feel bold in the steps we take locally and globally to serve your kingdom. Whether it's through prayers, financial giving, engaging in government, or any other multitude of ways, may we never stop trying to bring your kingdom of peace on earth. May we never stop serving the Lord who brings the outcasts in, who cares for the widow and the orphan, who wants to see the first last and the last first. In all we do, we pray you give us the ability to keep standing, serving, and working for you. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Amen.
God go before you to lead you. God go behind you to protect you. God go beneath you to support you. And God go beside you to befriend you. Do not be afraid. May the blessing of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you. Do not be afraid. Let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Please stand as we sing our closing song.
You're the Lion of Judah, the Lamb who was slain. You ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. The end of the age, when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you, and the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. With wisdom and justice in justice, your reign at your Father's side, and the angels will cry, that gather before you, and the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified, who descended to hell yet was raised up to reign at his Father's side, and the angels would cry, Hail the Lamb, who was slain for the world.
Peace to love and serve the Lord.